It doesn't matter if you're new to two-factor authentication or you've been doing it for years. Most people still make the common mistakes of using SMS text verification, limiting which accounts they use 2FA on, and worst of all, not creating proper backup systems. My name's Josh, this is All Things Secured, and today I'm going to explain why you're probably doing 2FA wrong and how you can avoid making these same mistakes that completely negate the security that two-factor authentication provides. This video is made possible by trendmicro, a complete device and identity protection for you and your family. Speaking of devices, let's jump in with the number one most common mistake with 2FA, which is choosing to receive your codes via SMS text when there are other options available. Now, I realize that for some accounts, SMS text and phone calls might be your only option. That's the case for me and my Chase Bank, which frustrates the heck out of me, honestly, but there's little I can do about it right now. The reason this is such a big deal is that your mobile phone provider is actually a weak link in your security chain. It's far too easy for somebody to impersonate you and steal your phone number, an attack known as SIM swapping, which then sends all of your texts and phone calls to the hacker's phone instead of yours. This happened to Jack Dorsey, then CEO of Twitter back in 2019. His Twitter account wasn't hacked, but a low-level customer support representative from his mobile provider was scammed. And once the hackers were able to gain control of Jack's phone number to receive 2FA codes via text, it was very simple to log in as Jack on Twitter and to start posting crazy racist comments that made international headlines. If Jack's phone can be SIM swapped and compromised, so can yours. If you're still receiving codes via text, and you probably are, I suggest logging into those accounts to see if they offer more secure forms of two-factor authentication, such as an authenticator app or even a 2FA security key. By the way, a quick bonus tip for those of you super security nerds. If you can't get away from SMS text verification, but you still want stronger security, there are alternative, more secure mobile phone providers that put specific protections in place to stop SIM swapping attacks. I'll link to an article describing those below. And while you're thinking about it, why not go the extra step of protecting your entire Android or iOS device with mobile security from this week's sponsor, trendmicro. Check this out. I have their premium security suite, which covers all the devices in my home and allows me to scan those devices for any security vulnerabilities. In this case, you can see that they recommend I set up a guard so I don't accidentally visit malicious websites, set up protection from suspicious links and calendar events, and even enable lost device protection. On my Mac or a PC, trendmicro offers protection against ransomware, and if you're not already using a password manager, they have that as well. When you combine this with dark web monitoring, a secure VPN for public Wi-Fi, and a lot of other features, there's obviously a lot of value offered here. Learn more about the trendmicro premium security suite in the link you see here or in the description. So once you start moving away from SMS text as your primary form of two-factor authentication and towards authenticator apps and 2FA keys, the next most common mistake I see people make is being just very picky about which accounts they enable 2FA on. I mean, at a bare minimum, you always hear me say that you need to have 2FA active for your email, financial accounts, investment accounts, etc. But that's just the bare minimum. My rule of thumb is this: if an online account offers you 2FA as an available security setting, you take it. It's that simple. Once you start using 2FA on a day-to-day basis, it won't be nearly as daunting as it feels right now. And at this point, I'm quite used to just pulling out my 2FA key on my keychain and using that and plugging it in whenever it's requested. And if you're comfortable storing some of your 2FA authenticator codes in your password manager, and many of those password managers now offer that, that makes it even more convenient. Whatever your threat model allows, my point is this: it is a mistake not to be securing most of your accounts with 2FA. And last, but definitely not least, proper backup. Please, please don't click away yet, because this is the one thing that I get emails about more than anything else. People locked out of their accounts, people who can't access their crypto wallets anymore, people who lose online assets. The list just goes on and on. Here are my thoughts in a nutshell. Using two-factor authentication well means taking responsibility for your own security, and failing to set up proper backup is irresponsible and costly. So what do I mean by proper backup? A good backup meets the following criteria. It is a separate device kept in a separate location that is all equally secure. Now, when I say separate device, that means you're not just putting your authenticator codes on a different app on your same mobile device. In other words, having Google Authenticator and Authy with the same 2FA code is not a strong backup. If you lose your device, you're stuck. The strongest backup in this case is having two 2FA security keys, which are two different devices. But this only works if it meets the second criteria, which means keeping this in a separate location. I keep one key on me at all times and one stored securely away. The only problem with this setup is that it makes it a little tricky to add new 2FA because I have to go and grab my backup before proceeding, but really that is proper backup and it's rarely ever convenient. Finally, having a backup that is equally secure follows the logic that you're only as strong as your weakest link. If your primary 2FA is a strong security key, but your backup is SMS text, you're actually downgrading your security, not upgrading it. I'm gonna finish this off here with some good news. Identity verification is quickly evolving and you're probably already using it without realizing. Perhaps you open your computer with your smartwatch or you verify a payment with facial recognition. Biometrics, or using something you are as a replacement for either passwords or even in some cases two-factor authentication, that's attractive because it's not something you can lose or forget. I always have my face and my fingerprint with me wherever I go. It's also very difficult to forge. We're probably gonna see things like the Apple Passkey and other similar services start to replace passwords. And as long as all of this verification is done locally on the device, it seems to be a secure option so far. But what do you think? Share your thoughts on using Face ID and fingerprints as verification in the comments below. And thanks again to our sponsor, Trend Micro. Click here to learn more about their device and identity protection services.